Welcome to Walking Together in the Wow. And we have a presentation here for you that has tremendous wow factor. So be disciplined and recognize your mind is about to be expanded, to say the least. And this is the result, for me, the result of consistency. Let us point out something that I feel is very important, and that is everyone has a go-to assertion, a repetitive go-to assertion. I am finding this to be of extreme help. This means an assertion that you repeat over and over and over, and you're able to go to it any time during the day. Whenever your mind is wandering in any situation, just go right back to it and start repeating it. So this is what I have been doing throughout my days now. And it's a very, 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 very effective help. So we're going to look at the repetitive practice that I am using. If we can shift over there. Okay. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Now, this is an assertion that actually comes from Jesus. And in fact, this is how Jesus puts it. If you were to come to me and ask just for one bit of advice, if you came away and said, I just want one bit of advice from you, Jesus, and that's it. Nothing more than that. Jesus says, okay, this would be it. To say this assertion as often as you can during the day would be the one bit of advice that I would give to you. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. So I have made this assertion my own. In other words, I've taken the advice. It's like if you give someone a gift, some practical utilitarian gift, and you visit them and they're using it. Like you give them a grill, or you give them some kitchen appliance, a blender, and they're using it all the time. And you say, oh wow, that's great. You know, someone's, you know, using the gift that I gave them because I knew it would be practically helpful for them. So Jesus gives us this repetitive assertion because he knows it's extremely helpful for us. So what is he hoping? He's hoping that we actually use it. He's hoping we actually use it. And so what I've done out of gratitude to Jesus and all the efforts he has made to awaken us from this horrible, you can't even explain the delusion, self-delusion that we are in. I say, you know what? I'm going to take his advice. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me, and I've been able to turn it into a repetitive practice. So, let's say we were to go to Jesus and we asked him, as I did, is there anything I can do to that would be, you know, supremely helpful for me, supremely helpful for me. And ultimately, I was able to get this very, very simple assertion. And, you know, we may think, oh, I want something grander than that, something bigger than that. What good is this? Well, I tell you, it is very, 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 very helpful. Very helpful. Okay. Now, why is this so helpful? Because the fact is that the freedom, our freedom that God gave us, is always knocking at our door. The truth of our freedom in God is always knocking at our door. The truth of our freedom in God is always knocking at our door. And this is a fact. This is a fact. And actually, This frightens us. This frightens us. Because I've always said that our greatest fear is our fear of ultimate success. This is what terrorized us. We're very frightened of that. And so this truth is always knocking, the truth of our freedom in God is always knocking at our door. And we're afraid to answer that door. So we go to, for instance, we go to someone who has answered the door, answered the knock at the door. And Jesus is one of those who's answered the knock at the door. Open the door to their perfect freedom in God. And we say, Jesus, I'm really afraid of this knocking at my door. So, you know, what do I do? Is there something you can give me that will help me with this terrible fear? And Jesus says, indeed there is. In fact, there's one super powerful assertion you can make that is going to be ultimately successful in evaporating your fear, and that is to repeat, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. So we might say, well, now basically we might say, okay, let me try it. So I have been using this now for quite some time. You might say, what, January, February, March, April, almost 4 months. And hasn't been any pyrotechnics. The path that we're on seems to be devoid of all these spiritual pyrotechnics, bells and whistles and lights and all this kind of stuff. It seems to be devoid of that. But what has happened, is the root of our suffering, the root of our self-delusion has been illuminated. And I'm looking at it. In fact, this morning, I was looking at that which I've always wanted to look upon. Death, what is death? And now I see what it is, actually. And this is a big wow thing. I'm in the wow of this, actually, now. I'm in the wow of this. As I'm doing this taping, I'm in the wow. I've been able to finally see what death is really about. And, we are burdened with this fear. We're burdened with this fear. What we really are is we're spirit. See, I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And yet we have this burden. We have this concern. We're worried. We're like something I feel... that somehow I'm oppressed, even though I'm spirit, I'm light, I'm not a body. I seem to be identifying with bodies, and these bodies seem to be dying, and I feel oppressed, and I feel like I'm going into a lot of fragmentation. I feel very fragmented, actually. I feel very fragmented like this. I don't feel like I'm spirit. You know, I don't feel like I'm spirit so much, even though I know that I am. Even though I know I am, I don't feel like I'm spirit. I feel very, very fragmented. And so, we want to know, what is this oppression? Can someone, bring the light to me? Can someone bring the light to me and tell me, why do I think that I'm a body? Why do I think that I'm not free? Why do I think that I'm no longer spirit? Why do I feel I'm subjected to body and to death and all of this? And I say that this assertion that I've been making, it has been fundamentally, powerfully evaporating my fear, my continuity fear, fear of success, to the point where now the light is now shining on death itself. And I'm seeing what it is, actually. I'm saying, wow. Oh, thank you. Thank you, Jesus, actually. Thank you, Jesus. Now, we're very afraid to be done with the grave. To be finished with the grave, actually. And why? We think, well, nobody else is. I'll be all alone. What's very important to know is that Jesus is... free of the grave before we were. And so we won't be all alone. Jesus is there, that is for sure. that Jesus is free of the grave. This is a powerful teaching of Christianity, is Jesus rose from the dead. He's free of the grave. Now, it's not been presented very clearly at all, and mostly in a dramatic, theatrical way, which is, we first related to it in that way because our clarity, our mental clarity, was not sufficient to relate to it, to have the light clearly shine upon it. But throughout the help that we have gotten and that I've been able to get and use, now the clear light is shining upon this. Okay. The clear light of reason is now shining upon this issue. And I'm no longer in this very, you know, tormented, fragmented, emotionalized condition, saying, screaming out, why, you know, why, you know, tormented. No longer a tormented soul. The fragmentation, all of that has been smoothed out. It's more and more smoothed out, smoothed out, smoothed out, smoothed out. And I'm in the wow of it. And as we know, in the wow of it, as we go into the wow of recognition, we're not in some sort of frantic necessity to explain. Now, we can explain. And I'm now more in this sort of mode right here, where I feel, hey, the light is really shining on the totality of the situation. I'm really in this mode here, where the light is shining on the totality of the situation. And I'm just full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. But I'm just sharing this with you. I am seeing, it has been revealed and shown to me what death is really about. and say, wow. This is it's good to get to this. It's absolutely good to get to this. So, if you want to know what happens when you see clearly, it's shown to you clearly that, okay, this is why we identify with bodies, and this is why the bodies die. If you want to know what happens when you see this clearly, well, just about an hour ago I saw it very clearly, and I'm just. Just sitting here calmly talking, you know, sharing this with you, and everything is fine. Everything is fine. No worries. This is the benefit of practicing in this way that I've suggested, that's been suggested to me, and I'm suggesting to you, sharing with the world. You might say that the Holy Spirit suggested it to me, helped guide me. I asked the Holy Spirit, where can I go for right teachings? Where can I go for right teachings? And so I asked the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, can you direct me to what's going to be most beneficial to me so that I can be, you know, free from the grave? Really, free from the grave. Absolutely, I want to be free from the grave. And so then the Holy Spirit has, you know, suggested that I pay attention to the essential teachings of Jesus. And to apply this assertion. This Jesus says that do just this. Say it over and over and over and over and over. And you will get the benefit of it. So I say thank you, Holy Spirit, for leading me in the right direction. The Holy Spirit certainly has led me in the right direction. Holy Spirit is the voice of reason within us. It's the voice of truth within us. It's that which knows our freedom. It's that which knows our freedom. That which is absolutely aware of our freedom in God, absolutely aware of it, and not defending against it, not trying to make deals with it, which is what we are trapped in. What is oppressing us is really that we believe we made a deal with God. Okay, this is what's really oppressing us. Now, by the way, am I running down the street screaming, hey, I just saw the answer to death. I saw how we can be free of death. No, because I'm not stupid. I understand people's continuity fear, our continuity fear. And that there's a need for a great deal of discipline on the spiritual path to and patience to patiently allow this wow factor of our success to say, wow, I'm getting close. Wow, I'm getting close. Imagine if you were getting close to getting free of the grave, literally being free of the grave. Wouldn't that be, you know, elation and also part trepidation? So you'd have this mixture of elation and trepidation within you, you know, boiling, simmering. Okay, well, this is the wow. This is the wow. This is what I call it. Don't try to label it any other way. I just say label it just wow. This is a very abstract way of labeling, okay, which is important. It's a mixture of elation and trepidation. And what you do is you let this simmer. When you feel it, you know, you don't let it boil over. Okay. Turn the heat down just a little bit and just let it simmer. So you're simmering in the wow. Full stop in the wow. Or you might say that when you first see the inside, you might be boiling over with this wow feeling. And then just turn the flame off. And what happens, it stops boiling over, and it turns into just a simmer, just bubbling simmer. And then gradually the simmer even calms down, and there's just steam. It's just steam off of it. And gradually it cools off a little bit. Gradually it cools off a little bit. So imagine if you're a pot of water, you're boiling it, and it boils over. Turn off the flame, or turn it way down. Turn it way down. Turn it way down. So it all sort of cools down a little bit. Because when it's boiling over, you're like, oh my gosh, oh, this is too much for me. Turn it down, low flame, low flame, low flame. So it's even lower than simmering. It's just sort of steam is coming off, but it's not really, the water is gentle and peaceful again. It's not all roiling and boy, you know, okay. And just stay with that for a while until you calm down. Your spiritual heart rate calms down. Because you're saying, oh my gosh, I almost saw how to be free from the grave. Oh my gosh, this whole riddle, this puzzle, I almost saw it. Or I feel like I, for an instant, I glimpsed it, but I don't quite remember what it was, but I'm so close. This is big. This is a big deal. Okay, this is an extremely big deal. So the spiritual path is a big deal. It's an extremely big deal, and it's going towards ultimate success. And so, the glimpses that you're getting, that is, you know, it is absolutely incredibly important, and it's a huge deal for you. There's no way around that. That is a fact. So you have to manage your success. This is what this is the drum that I continually beat. You must always, in the forefront of your mind, no matter what, you know, what spiritual practice or what you're doing, whatever it is, in the forefront of your mind, you must realize that managing your success is always comes first. It always comes first. And you have to have that. Otherwise, you're going to stumble and panic and retreat and lose momentum. And losing momentum is a real pain, you know. It hurts real bad. So as I say, remain continuously engaged with your spiritual practice. And in order to do that, you have to manage your success properly. If you don't do that, you're going to retreat, you're going to lose interest, you lose momentum, lose interest, you're going to feel despair, and that is awful. And believe me, I have been there and done that. And just, you know, you learn through the school of hard knocks and frustration, but you want to minimize that as much as possible. This is what I'm here for, to help minimize that as much as possible. I don't wish that upon anyone. So, above all else, above even the teaching itself, is managing your success is the key to success. Managing your success is the key to success. And that is practicing full stop in the wow. Because you are most definitely going to catch glimpses of your freedom. And this will boil over. You'll be so elated. And also you'll have trepidation. And this mixture will boil over. And you'll feel like, oh, this is just like, just too much. I don't know, you know, I can't handle this. This is, you know, there'll be some inner, you know, you'd be sensitive to it. And you realize, wow. Well, what do? Full stop in this wow. Just calmly sit here. You're not doing anything. You're just sitting here. So just sitting is the key to success, actually. Not trying to translate anything into action is supremely important to managing your success on the spiritual path. Do not reject any impulse to translate what you just saw into action. This is called full stop in the wow. Now you may be asking me, how come you're not telling me, you know, how to be free of the grave? Because I'm in wow mode myself right now, you see. So I'm not going close to that right now, because the feeling of maybe I might want to translate it into action or something is still there. I can feel it. So I'm just letting that wow just sit there. I can talk about other stuff here. But right now I'm just letting that calm down within me, you see. You don't even have to translate it into words. You might just sit quietly, or you might talk about something else, but just let this not, but don't be distracted from it. It's stay close to it. Stay close to it. Just don't translate it into any action. Now, this is not easy for us, most of us, right? It's not easy. It's a discipline that you acquire, and it's always a bit difficult. So you have to use your will to do this. Say, I will not translate this into any action right now. I am simply sitting here doing nothing about it, getting used to it, getting familiar with this, getting familiar with the fact that I did see it. I did see this. There is an answer. I did glimpse the answer. And be sensitive to this wow. And when you glimpse something that's really heavy and you know it, say, hey, I think, I believe this wow, I know this wow is going to follow this. So let me just be, sit here quietly and give it time, and let's see how strong it gets. And very important, don't just spring into action. Say, oh yeah, okay, I glimpsed the end of death. Okay, great. I'm going to go out and be revved up about that. No, because you may have a delayed reaction. You know, shock, when we're in shock, we often don't know it. And so I would say on the spiritual path, you're in shock more than any other situation in the world. It's positive shock. It's like shock therapy, shock therapy treatment. But it's a positive shock in that you're glimpsing your freedom. And you're just saying, wow. It's a shock. And shock is often delayed. You know, in situations, some people go into shock in the world. They may keep functioning for a while and then it hits them and later, like, wow, oh, just really, wow. I don't know how I was even functioning, they say. So what we do is we anticipate the shock. We're wise. We say, hey, this is very shocking. I know it's going to have a reaction. So we treat it right from the beginning, we treat it, instead of before it gets real severe. And what this does is it smooths out the shock. And we recover from it much, much more quickly. And we don't lose our momentum. This is the brilliant wisdom of this practice and this way, is we treat shock from the very beginning. We recognize it. We give the very best treatment, and it smooths it out. And we don't allow it to panic us and catapult us off into all sorts of side trips. We don't even write poetry. We don't even write anything about it. So we refrain from action, speaking, writing, moving. We just sit here quietly. And we might think, oh my gosh, I just glimpsed freedom from the grave. I got to write about it. I used to do this. Or I have to compose a music. I used to do that too. I said, oh my gosh, I got to immortalize this in a song or in a poem or in prose. Or, you know, it has to be, I have to mark this milestone. I have to give the world, I have to show the world that I've reached this milestone. I've got to, you know, concretize it. It's this that you must refrain from. This is what messes you up. This is what slows you down. And I know your creativity wants to spring to the front and say, ah, I'm inspired. I'm creatively inspired. Okay, this is the troublemaker. It's much more important to convince yourself that you can get back to that glimpse than it is to have your so-called creativity do a riff on it. You know, the creativity is actually just working with images, which is a memory of glimpsing it. It's not true creativity. So don't be fooled by this so-called creativity trying to insist that you now give your efforts over to this. What we want to do haven't eaten anything this morning or drinking anything. I just got out of bed, so I have to tape. That's okay. So what we want to do is convince ourselves, prove to ourselves, we can handle this insight, we can handle this clarity, so that we can go back to it. And that it can be with us more and more, and ultimately all the time, constantly. That is what's important. This will really recover for us true creativity, which is not working with images, actually, or memories, or reactions. True creativity is not actually a reaction. So this is what's important. I didn't really get my system going this morning. I just literally got out of bed and I've gone straight into taping here. Because I recognize the importance of this. I says right away, I said, oh wow. just saw it. And I've been wanting to see this for a long time, but the Holy Spirit always says, calm down, we'll get to it, we're getting to it, you just have to get to it in the right way. And I said, well, what about death? What's the answer? Said, well, we're getting there. Just don't try to seize upon it directly. It has to be put into the right context. Oh, hummingbird just showed up. Nice. Hey, good morning. It has to be put into the full, correct, clear context. So don't strain or struggle about that. So I didn't. I trusted the Holy Spirit. I said, okay. And now I see, you know, I see it in context. Based on the progress I've made day after day after day, especially recently, really a huge, huge breakthrough. So I'm just sitting here on this recognition. And this is what I advise all of you. When you get a recognition, when you get a glimpse, as you most certainly will, just sit on it. Just sit with it. Just full stop in the wow. Walking together in the wow. Sitting together in the wow, maybe is even a better way of putting it. Sitting together in the wow. But walking gives a connotation of we're making progress, so that's also a good way to say it. You know, we're walking together in the wow. As we just sit on this and sit with it patiently. You see, it takes a while for something that's boiled over, that's super hot, to cool off a little bit. It takes a while. We do need to cool off a little bit. Just imagine a lifetime of misery and horrible suffering and confusion and desperate attempts to understand what is this? Why are we subject to the grave? Now I see the answer to this. Imagine the elation that you know, would be present with that. But also I say that you must be super smart and also super disciplined, okay? So it's the discipline, it's the practice that enables one to be super smart and see this. It's the discipline that is the enabler. Now I know there are many who feel, oh, the brilliance is enough. I'd be so smart, I can just see it and that's good. No, it isn't good enough. And this is the struggle we all go through. It's very aggravating. We think, well, I should be able to just recognize this and that's it. No, because of our continuity fear, the fear of success. And this mixture of elation and trepidation that comes up when we see it. And then great necessity for false creativity not to grab a hold of this and saying, okay, now I'm inspired. Now I can inspire you. Now I can make you happy with images. Okay. Not that we need to discard images altogether right now. No, I do some work with graphics after everything is cooled down. It is possible. You have to be careful about it. You have to somehow tie it back into your practice. But don't let break the spell of that. I call it, it's really false creativity. Working with images is not true creativity. Jesus points this out to us very clearly. That working with images is not true creativity. So, do not allow that false creativity to commandeer, you know, your attention, your life, your path. It's interesting. I cannot go back to these images now. As I click on this button, it doesn't work. That's quite funny. It's actually grinding its wheels right now to see You know, can I go back to that or what? So this is an example. A very good example of it's sort of stuck. It sort of stopped recording right now, but somehow it should pop back here. Yeah, it shows it's still recording, so I'll just keep going here. So there's a good example. Just sit in the wow of this. Don't let the image creativity, whether it's music, writing, any sort of, you know, any of that, don't let that grab a hold of you. Just full stop in the wow, as I am stopped right now. And as this video seems to be completely full stopped in the wow, for everything froze up. That's really funny. Holy Spirit bringing my attention to it. So just like full stop, as if it's just a single image here and you just stopped on that. This is what I'm experiencing. The monitor is just froze up. Everything froze up. Hopefully it will unfreeze at some point. And even the mouse is gone. Everything's gone. Okay. Well, that's fine. This is a perfect example. Now, gradually, as the wow cools off, you're able to start sort of looking at it, talking about it, looking at it again. Say, let me start getting my courage to kind of look back at what I glimpsing it again, looking at it again, the insight that you had, the recognition that you had, be able to look at. Just continue to stay. Don't let creativity, false creativity, seize your mind. Don't let it intimidate you. Don't think you have to do something about this. Like somehow you're obligated to concretize it. No, you're not. Not at all. Our only obligation is to accept our own freedom and thereby be an example to others. Because that's where we'll find true creativity. That's where we'll find true creativity. Freedom, perfect freedom, is true creativity, actually. And now it's becoming unfrozen here a little bit. So the computer got very buggy there. And that's like when we go into a wow, you know, it's just things suddenly get overloaded. We feel overloaded subtly. We feel subtly overloaded. And this is why it's so important to not use stimulants on the spiritual path. It is so important to not use stimulants. Sex, drugs, rock and roll, so to speak. That basically refers to is a way of referring to the whole range of stimulants. Do not use any of those. Well, what's going on here now? This is funny. The picture just shifted. Okay. This is great. This is like, I don't even know. I just go with the flow here. What happened? I don't know. It's just going. That's fine. So don't use any stimulants. Why? Because you will not recognize the symptoms of the wow quickly enough. And you probably won't recognize them at all. You'll just ride roughshod over it. But the shock will still be there. It's just you'll think, oh, I'm a super person. I don't need to. I can just plow right through this. Recognizing the early symptoms of this wow and catching it early is all important to smoothing it out, recovering smoothly, successfully, and quickly, and maintaining your momentum. It's all important for that. Where's the mouse? How did this happen? Okay, somehow it shifted over to mirrored. Okay, that's fine. We've made a shift here. We can stay with that shift. I don't have to shift it back. So it may feel in the wild like you've shifted, like mirrored. You've been shifted into this different perspective. And you just say, okay, that's fine. It's very similar, isn't it? I mean, it's just what was on the right is now on the left. What was on the left is now on the right. It's a mirror image. That's okay. It's still familiar enough with familiar, right? So don't have to do anything about it. So again, what is the key to success? Managing your success is the key. So this is where we place our emphasis. Because the better you get at managing your success, the more glimpses of your freedom you will get. This is guaranteed. Automatic. And I know that this is very difficult for everyone to accept. We're taught the opposite, that we're just supposed to power through with our intellect, our emotions, our cleverness, our ambitions, our go-get-itiveness, our seductiveness, our deceitfulness. We're just supposed to power through with our cleverness, and we think that this is how we get it, because this is how we get position and things and comforts in the world, right? So it seems how we get it. So when we hear the teacher saying, look, first step is learn how to sit quietly and start getting good at being quiet. That is actually the all-important first step. This sets you up then. You will automatically start catching glimpses of your freedom then. So the better you're able to manage the wow, manage your success, the quicker, faster your path will go. There are some who are so good at it, apparently, that their path goes very quickly. But it's likely they have had much practice in previous identification attempts, we call previous lives, which are really previous attempts at identifying with fixation. But they're so good at this that they're able to go very fast. There's a few of those. But that's pretty rare, and it's always has to do with previous efforts. So we're not spared from the necessity to become expert at it ourselves. It's not luck. It is not luck at all. It is not just genetics or good fortune. It has nothing to do with it. It is literally your practice, the efforts you put in. And I'm certainly an example of that, which has been nothing but this tremendously gritty, tenacious effort in my entire life. That's it. Just true grit. I have not been spared one bit from that. You may think, well, I've associated it with these great teachers and had contact with them, etc. But I haven't been spared one bit from this necessity to apply true grit and the will to keep on keep on with that. I always say, well, can't you make it easier? And they say, yeah, we're trying, but you need to be able to manage your success and learn to sit quietly and don't let this false creativity, you know, commandeer your life, your attention here. Back off. And if you do some creativity, relate it directly to sitting, to full stop in the wow, sitting quietly. Loop it directly back into that. Okay? Don't do it to inspire somebody just for the sake of saying, oh, look what a great artist I am, or look how creative I am. Don't do that. Loop it back into full stop in the wow, repetitive assertion, managing your success. Loop it directly back into that. So I don't know if I can pull up any more images or not. It doesn't seem like that's happening. Very great. Or maybe it will now. I don't know. It's not really. Well, we'll see. So loop it directly back into your practice. And keep it simple. Now, that's not easy to do. It's a discipline, isn't it? It's a discipline. I struggle with that too. And ultimately, it's the practice that is way more important than the false creativity. way more important. This working with images, however you do it, this false creativity of time, space, process, and form, and all of this, it's a trifle. It's a trifle, actually. It's not that important. But do not deify it. Do not deify your creativity. If you have those coming to you, worshiping you, if you're very creative, worshiping you for this false creativity, and using you, trying to make images be their god or goddess. This is a very dangerous thing. Very dangerous. I have a friend who actually succumbed to this situation. A famous friend, actually, very bad. And it was certainly a lesson for me to pay attention to. Be very careful about that. Do not ever put yourself in a situation where you're going to be idolized for your creativity. Always make it sitting in silence is what I'm about. Managing, full stop in the wow is what I'm about. And allowing a glimpse of our freedom to come from that, and insisting that others, if they want to associate with me, that others also have the same discipline. Otherwise, you can be pulled into people pulling you into creativity for fame and fortune and idolization and all of that, and things will go very bad for you when you get into this. And I have literally gone through that myself in the life just previous to this one. I can testify to this, and I've learned through extremely brutal disappointments. I just unmirrored it here. I literally had, you know, state funeral, literally had, you know, massive funeral parade. Literally had, you know, just it was a huge thing when I passed away, and because of my creativity. But this is false creativity. Creativity in music. And so I was idolized for that. And people looked to me for salvation, but they were looking to my creativity, my false creativity, for their salvation. And this does not save you from the grave. Does not save you from the grave. Music does not save you from the grave. No false creativity, no graphics, no amount of false creativity saves you from the grave. Only seeing the clarity, the light of pure reason, saves you from the grave. Actually, literally seeing and recognizing, and you say, ah, this is why I'm binding myself to the grave. Oh, now I see. Now I see it very clearly. And letting, you know, being comfortable with the wow of that. Only that saves from the grave. No symphony saves you from the grave. Now, I don't say who I was in a past life, because I don't want people bothering me saying, oh, give us your creativity. Oh, you know, oh, you know, yeah. I say, no. Been there and done that. So I feel I'm very uniquely helpful in a certain way, especially to those who have this, you know, are very creative, very brilliant, very creative. I know what the problem is, and I know the downfall of that, and I know how to get free of that. You have to put the spiritual path first and recognize the other is a mere trifle. It is not something that should be elevated on an equal level. And that's what I got caught up into this life. As I came into this life determined to get free of this and get free of the grave. And I was going great, but I didn't know how to manage my success properly. And so then I got tricked into going back to creativity and being told that, well, creativity needs to be on an equal level with reason, so to speak, clear reason. And so I tried to elevate, I tried to have to bring about a situation where both were equal. And this is a drastic mistake. And I've paid brutally for this mistake. It's, I call it the muse, the goddess, is how I was approached. Is this inspirational archetype, which says, let there be beautiful colors and artwork and culture and all this. And it appears as an archetype, as a goddess, who is saying that she is equal to God, so to speak. God mean the clear light of recognition of our true freedom, and that we need to integrate the two and make them equal. This is a drastic lie. This is taking this false creativity of working with images and claiming that this is true creativity. That's equal to true creativity of our pure freedom. In no way is it equal. It is a mere trifle, and a misleading trifle at that. So, once again, I got suckered by the muse. And the wages of that is you taste the grave again, and you get a return ticket. I mean, just living in this world, you're tasting the grave constantly. It's like a living death, really, is the situation. That's froze up again. Okay, freeze up again if you want to. That's fine. All right. It got unfrozen. Well, see, so I got frozen, and I'm unfrozen. So there's been this long, I've had this long battle with this false creativity, trying to get free of it. And the goddess promises you, the muse, the god, the archetype of false creativity is what it really is. It's always appeared to me as this goddess-like being with beautiful clothes and flowers and music and culture, and saying, look, you can do this. Let me inspire you to do this. And so then I say, okay, this looks like it'll really help people because people love this. And the goddess says, yes, everybody loves this. They love beautiful music and staging and clothes and flowers and food and the beautiful high life, the beautiful, wonderful. This is elevates them. It you know, inspires them and all this stuff. And you know, you end up then serving the goddess of culture, high culture, which is a false path. It is most definitely a false path. It is not, false creativity is not equal to true creativity. That's like saying, you know, and we can get all very cute about it too. And the God, those who are under the influence of this can be very clever in their cuteness and about it. But in no way is working with images the same thing as experiencing our absolute freedom. There's no way you can equate that. So look out. For if you try to get cute about it through intellectual cleverness, it's like say, well, light and dark are the same, you know, in pure spaciousness or whatever is the same. No, false creativity working with images is not the same as experiencing our true freedom. That's like saying experiencing spaciousness as an image is the same experiencing as experiencing spaciousness as spaciousness. It's not the same experience. One is tasting the grave, the other is freedom from the grave. There's no way that we can worship images and place images on this pedestal without tasting the grave, without this living death. Only when we see what's really going on, then we say, then we put it in the right perspective. And say, well, I don't have to attack images or get rid of imagery, etc. But I realize that it's not equal whatsoever. And any ideology or teaching that teaches this is a false teaching and needs to be shunned. What do you do with false teaching? Do you attack it? No, you shun it. Turn away from it. Turn your back on it. But because of our continuity fear, you know, we're very gentle with ourselves. Truth is very gentle. And so we're not asked to, you know, reject all creativity completely. But you must keep a very close watch on this and be very strict about it. And we can look at the history, for instance, of the Catholic Church, for instance, which came out of, it's part of the discipline. You know, as I say, managing your success and the discipline of this is the key to success. So this is what it was focused on largely. And they put very severe restrictions on this false creativity. Very severe restrictions. Okay, someone just is moving around here, so. And this is totally valid. Totally valid. But what's more important is you, yourself, putting severe restrictions and managing your success. And you'll go much faster than just some institution doing it. You may say, well, I don't need any institution telling me what to do anymore. I'm liberated from that. Well, fine. That means that you're actually even better at it. Then you're even more careful. I have like this squad of like spiritual bodyguards. It's like guarding this false creativity at all times. But it's imprisoning it, very severe imprisonment. Make sure, you know, it doesn't get the best of me again, as it has many times. Many times in many places has gotten the best of me, as it has gotten the best of you. So when in doubt, be austere about this, because we have an extreme tendency to fall into this trap of false creativity. We have this extreme tendency. And it's the most dangerous tendency for us to try and equate image with reality. And to try to say that they're the same, they're equal, is the most drastic and suffering ideology. We can't get rid of our creativity. It's impossible. But in the situation, this so-called deal we think we made with God, this deal actually, we just basically entrapped ourselves in a false deal. There is no deal. Reality doesn't make any deals. God has never made any deal. There's no deal, actually. Yet we think we've made a deal with God. And so we are trapped in the deal we think we've made with God. This is our problem. And in this so-called deal we think we've made with God, we end up identifying with bodies, and those bodies end up dying. It's inevitable, because that is staying true to the deal. We feel we have to stay true to the deal in order to be greater than God. See, we think this deal has made us greater than God, and yet the price we're paying is that we are now, we bind ourselves to this so-called deal because we think we've bound God to this deal. And the wonderful truth is that we have not bound God to this deal. Reality has no deals. It's perfect. There's no deals to be made whatsoever. So God is not bound by any such deal. This is the wonderful liberating truth. And therefore, neither are we. And therefore, we don't have to identify with bodies. We don't have to imagine that there are such a thing as bodies, time, space, process, or form. We don't have to imagine it. We don't have to be bound by it. And we don't have to sacrifice bodies to God in order to continue to get bodies to identify with, in order to be fair to God. Because in this deal we think we've made, we think the only way to be fair to God and to show that we're holding up our portion of the deal is to sacrifice these bodies, which means death. Sacrifice these bodies to God. Showing, okay, God, we're giving you your freedom as long as you also give us our freedom to fixate with bodies, you see. So we get bodies. That's why we have this cycles of birth and death. This is exactly why. Is this is being true. We're showing we're being faithful to the deal we made with God. We're saying, okay, God, you're going to allow us to fixate on bodies. Okay, and that's what we want. And what you want is you want us to be free of fixation on bodies. So we'll then allow bodies to die. Okay, we'll sacrifice the bodies. So as long as we believe we can make a deal with God, we will be bound by the grave. Period. There's absolutely no way around this. This is still recording. Everything has gone so interestingly in this video. It looks like it is. Yeah, great. This has been a wonderful video, full of all sorts of situations popping up here. So getting to this wisdom, this is a huge wow. You see the absolute nature of what we're talking about, right? As long as we believe any deal, a deal, period, any deal whatsoever can be made with God, we will continue to be bound by the grave. There's no way around it. Call a deal, you can call it compromise. It's the same thing. It's a deal. So let's not, again, let yourself get cute with it. Because the intellect will jump in and says, I can get cute with that. I can find a way around that. And it just becomes a wordsmith and thinks that it can chase its tail that way, you know, and confuse the issue. So let us not confuse the issue. It's cut and dried. As long as we believe that any sort of deal can ever be made with God, even in the slightest way, we will continue to be bound by the grave. Period. That's it. No way around it whatsoever. So we can assert, yes, I already know, that as long as I believe that any sort of deal whatsoever can ever be made with God, no matter how small, I will continue to be bound by the grave. Yes, I already know this. I already see this. Yes, I already see that any attempt to make any deal with God whatsoever, I will continue to be bound by the grave. I already see that if, as long as I continue to make any sort of deal with God whatsoever, I will continue to be bound by the grave. So we can assert this, you see. We can assert this, and this helps us. Because we get used to seeing this. So yeah, I can see this. I can be comfortable with this absolute. This is an absolute. No way around it. Yes, I already know that I already see that any attempt, as long as I make any attempt to make a deal with God, I will continue to be bound by the grave, and there is absolutely no way around this whatsoever. So you see here, we are not allowing false creativity to commandeer us, to usurp us. We're not freaking out or panicking. What we're doing is we allow the wow to settle down, cool down. What we're doing, we're flipping it. We flip the script back into what? Assertions. So now we're literally asserting what we caught a glimpse of, which means we're further along on the path. We're further along. Yes, I already know that I already see that as long as I make any attempt whatsoever to make a deal with God, I will continue to be bound by the grave, and there's absolutely no way around this. And we say this not in a miserable, despairing way, but in a elated way, positive way. We're like, this is fantastic that we can assert this, that our clarity can rest upon this. Yes, I already know that. I already see that as long as I try to make any attempt whatsoever to make a deal with God, I will continue to be bound by the grave, and there's absolutely no way around this. You see, it's getting easier. Yes, I already know that. I already see that as long as I attempt to make any deal whatsoever with God, I will continue to be bound by the grave, and there's no way around this whatsoever. And our reaction to this, it's just a wow, okay? We're not trying to figure this out. When making assertions, we already recognize, then flipping the script, we already recognize this is true. So we just assert it. We don't try to figure out, now, why is this true? Why is this true? No, you don't do that during the assertions. You're not trying to figure out why is it true. You're just asserting it with positivity. Yes, I already know that. I already see that as long as I make any attempt whatsoever to make a deal with God, I will continue to be bound by the grave, and there's no way around this whatsoever. Now, what is this doing? It's bringing up more wow feeling, for sure. Because this is being more adamant. You see, we're adamantly recognizing our clarity. We recognize our clarity in a very adamant, clear way here. And so that brings up a wow. No question about it. It's an elation to be able to clearly state this all-important statement. For sure that's going to be elation, because it's demonstrating how, tremendously far along we are here. So yes, I already know that. I already see that as long as I try to make any deal whatsoever with God, I will continue to be bound by the grave, and there's absolutely no way around this. Now this froze up again, but it shows it's still recording. Yeah, okay. There's absolutely no way around this. So to get to be able to assert this is a tremendous milestone. And again, what do? Warning. If you don't stop it now, let me see, it says, warning. How am I? I'm not getting close to two. See, warning, if you close the program, the catching will be stopped. Would you like to continue? Would you like, yeah. Well, it might stop it. This is very buggy. It's getting very buggy. So maybe I just won't click on anything. Don't click. I think last time I clicked on yes, it stopped it. Would you like to continue? Yes, it stops it. So let me just not click on anything and just continue. I'll outsmart the bugginess maybe. I don't know. But what's important in this wow is don't go running back into your creativity, your false creativity. Delay that. Delay it. Delay it. Delay it. First, get used to this. First, just get used to this. Full stop in the wow. You're not letting your creativity play at all with this. Wow. You're staying in neutral. Don't put your car in gear. Don't put the car or false creativity in gear. Just stay neutral. Keep it in neutral. Even though you might be thinking, hey, the engine's revving really high. If I put it in gear, I'll really be able to go places. No, keep it in gear. Let the RPMs die down. Let the engine cool down. Slow down. Now, the goddess of false creativity is most the archetype that is will pester you. You can say it's the ego also. We'll say, well this what you're teaching is true, though. It's very clever to say, yes, what you're teaching is true, and I'm so admire what you do. You know, this is a teaching you're giving is so admirable. But it's too difficult for people. You know, it's what about the people who can't do this? What about those? They need to be inspired too. You know, so you need to help them out too. And this is the spiel that you get from the ego. The ego will praise you and say, yeah, you're doing wonderful. You're great. This is awesome. But hardly anybody is paying attention. It's too difficult. You know, so you need to get into. This is the trick. The snake is trying to bite you. It's not too difficult. It's that our arrogance in making us in believing we can be greater than God, and we can force a deal upon God that God has to accept. This is what the trouble is, and our continuity fear of success frightens us, so we have to learn to manage our success. And it's this false creativity that's interfering with people's ability to do this. So feeding this false creativity just makes the situation worse. Because people say, I don't need to do that. I've got a beautiful band. I got a band playing there. Let's go dancing. I've got someone to dance with who's wearing beautiful clothes. I'm wearing beautiful clothes. We've got flowers in our hair. You know? And let's go watch the sunset together. And let's party all night. And, you know, goes on and on like that. I feel inspired. I feel inspired by love, they say. This is false. This is false. This is false teaching. So it's the false teaching that is luring us away from success. So when the false teaching comes, you says, hey, the people are having difficulty. You need to inspire them by doing this. No, you're just literally helping them be lured away. You need to inspire the world by showing that you are not, that you have gotten free of this entrapment of false creativity. And at the same hand, you're not being punitive about it either. I mean, I can still do some graphics, which I do. I can do some extremely beautiful graphics, actually. But I always loop them straight back into the practice, and it's the practice that's important. So what I'm showing you is that you don't have to reject this false creativity and attack it and feel guilty or sinful about it. What you have to do is you have to put it under severe restraint, straitjacket it, and allow it out of a sense of continuity. You out of honoring your true creativity, which is actually engaged in this false creativity, you allow it under great restriction. to breathe a little bit. But the restrictions have to be very severe, given our history. You know, and we see with the world, when you lift those restrictions, you see what happens. When you lift those restrictions, you get the world the way it is not right now. And of course, the false creativity thinks, this is wonderful, we're going to a golden age. You know, we're finally getting recognized as equal. You know, this false creativity is saying, finally, we're getting due recognition to this false creativity and elevating it to an equality with true creativity, which is absolute freedom. That's like saying fixation is the same as absolute freedom. But again, those are completely mutual exclusives. You can't have mutual exclusives equal. This is what Jesus is teaching. The root of it, the heart of it is this. Truth and lies cannot be both true. This is the root of Jesus' teaching. Truth and lies cannot both be true. And you can't use radical Dzogchen to get around this thinking that, oh no, they're equally true. That is not so. It's absolutely not so. Truth and lies can't both be true, plain and simple. The experience of fixation is not the same experience of absolute freedom. Because in absolute freedom, we recognize there's no such thing as fixation. So, you can't say we're having our cake and eat it too. We're having fixation but not experiencing it. That is not true. That's not what radical Dzogchen says at all, actually. What happened in this culture is this goddess, return of the goddess of culture, of false creativity, trying to elevate itself into equality with true creativity, used certain Eastern teachings, misinterpreted them, and made us think that somehow the teachings of Christianity were oppressive, that we're oppressing false creativity, and that these Eastern teachings showed us the true light, which it say that it's equal. Yeah. This is a very, very disingenuous misinterpretation of the Eastern teachings. Actually, the Western teachings have been accurate, and they focus more on the discipline, okay, of restricting this false creativity and seeing it in the right light, that it's not true creativity at all, and basically telling us we are all sinners. That is absolutely true, because to be a sinner means you think that we can make a deal with God, that making a deal with God, with reality, with pure spaciousness, making a deal with God, we believe it's possible. That's a sinner. So we are all severe sinners. Any taste of the grave whatsoever means we're a severe sinner, period. And we have to discipline and severely restrict false creativity, because it holds us to the grave. It holds us to the grave because it's based on the belief that we can make a deal with God, which is absolutely not true. So the Western traditions have been accurate. They're not inferior to the Eastern teachings. Now, ultimately, they're equal at the highest understanding. Okay? But we've had some very clever saboteurs, really, work this angle of as if the Eastern teachings somehow teach that the equality of false and true creativity, which isn't what they're really saying. But they can, under taking them out of context, they can be twisted in that way and give the impression that that's what they're saying, even though that's not what they're saying. And indeed, the Eastern teachings have a great, very severe discipline on false creativity as well. Now, Islam has extremely strict restrictions against false creativity. And that's why many people in the world are so frightened of it. One of the reasons is these restrictions are extremely severe because they feel it's recognized that this is a severe problem we have. Now, you do run a risk of becoming too severe in the restrictions. You know, so you do have to be gentle and forgiving and compassionate with this, and you cannot make restrictions a religion in itself. You cannot let that become all encompassing. So you can go overboard in that direction, and you become severely iconoclastic. You know, and so there is a middle path in terms of that, but the middle path in no way suggests that false creativity should be raised to the level of true creativity. It does not mean that at all. It means as you go along the path to completely rejecting false creativity and setting it down entirely, as you go along that path, don't be overly severe with yourself. Okay? Don't be overly severe. Be very severe, but not to an extreme extent. This is what the middle path, well, this is what Buddha pointed out, is that don't go through these austerities and try to kill yourself to try to get rid of this false creativity. He tried to starve it out of himself. And he said, no, that doesn't work. It's still there. It's still there. But in no way was Buddha or Buddhism ever suggesting that we shouldn't be extremely severe with this false creativity. It just says, don't go too far with it. Have some compassion. With, in other words, the middle path means you need to at least understand you have this continuity fear, and if you try to be too severe, it's going to cause problems as well. But absolutely, the Eastern teachings are very severely restricting of this false creativity, as have been the Western traditions. Okay, so the goddess of false creativity basically has tried to deceive the world. She's always trying to deceive the world. Call it the ego. The ego is an abstract way of referring to it, but as it plays out, it has a component of this goddess-like component to it, of attractiveness, very much attracting to the body, attracting to glamour, attracting to the beauty of the body, attracting to the fashion and clothing and artwork and music and everything that surrounds, sort of a frame surrounding worshiping of the body, worshiping of fixation. And so it tends to play out as a goddess, you know, type of religion, goddess type of belief, worshiping the goddess. So this goddess has been very active, seducing the world, spiritually seducing the world away from what actually works. And the result of this is the present day culture of this world. It left us wide open and vulnerable for really being taken over by what I say cosmic corporate culture, incorporating us like we're some small business, and this bigger business comes in and swallows us up. And throughout the cosmos, there's this very big business of false creativity, worshiping imagery, reacting to memory images. This is false creativity, and this is throughout the cosmos. So there's a very big corporation, cosmic corporate culture, and it comes into like a planet like here, planet Earth, and it swallows us up and incorporates us, take over. Just like corporations here in this world, they say, oh, this business would be helpful for me. They come in and make a huge deal. They get on the board of directors. They ultimately vote to take it over. And this is what happens. Hostile takeovers happens all the time in business world. But on a cosmic scale, this is considered a hostile takeover. This planet has already happened. They stuffed the board of directors of this planet. You know, they got their people in the right places, in heads of state, heads of cabinets, heads of bureaucracy, heads of international organizations, heads of news, heads of entertainment, heads of education, all of this. They put their people in those places. And those people now are making decisions of saying, yeah, What we need to do is we need to elevate false creativity to true creativity, make them equal, and then we'll all be happy. See, we'll be happy. We're keeping our deal we made with God, and we're being happy at the same time. Everything's great. We solve the problem. And this is actually a hostile takeover of this planet. A very hostile takeover. Because it basically divests us of spiritual will to discipline ourselves and restrict this false creativity. Restrict it. As it has to be restricted, because ultimately we have to set it down and realize it has no value to us whatsoever. It's valueless. There's no such thing as fixation. It's impossible. So worshiping fixation is valueless ultimately to us. No matter how beautiful we try to make it, it's ultimately valueless to us. And we have to get to that recognition, and we have to get to the recognition it's impossible to make a deal with God. Absolutely impossible. We cannot. Therefore, we cannot entertain this idea of being greater than God without suffering this tasting of the grave, living death, actually. Now, however much we want to ornament the skeleton, you know, it still tastes like death. It still tastes like fear. No matter how much we want to dance and celebrate, and no matter what rituals we use, and all the sex and the drugs and the rock and roll we want to engage in, it still tastes like death. We can never get rid of that taste in this way. So, I have a lot of clarity about Eastern religions because, twofold. Why? Because I had to overcome this false seduction that the goddess was using about Eastern religions, making the West feel that the West is somehow drastically inferior and leading us astray, you know, and dropping the restrictions on false creativity. I had to become wise enough about Eastern religions so I could say, no, that's not what they're saying. That's a lie. That's a deception. Not all the Eastern teachers are enlightened. Even if they say they're Zogchen teachers, that doesn't mean they're enlightened. Not at all. And they're also subject to a great deal of misinterpretation contextually, you know, from the West. Absolutely it is. So we don't need to abandon our roots here in the West. We don't need to abandon our roots and say it was all terrible. It wasn't terrible, actually. Again, there is this false creativity that we think is true creativity. It is not. It is absolutely is not. And this comes from one who has been one, you know, a historical icon of false creativity, receiving great renown and fame and adulation from it. And I can say for sure it was false creativity, and that is not the way at all. It should definitely, absolutely be restricted. And of course, this is our false creativity is so angry at the church, saying you've been restricting me for so long, you've been holding me down for so long. This is wrong, you know. It is not wrong. It's wisdom. Absolutely. If you want to get free of the grave, there's no other way. You have to set it down eventually. You have to recognize there is no deal with God whatsoever. And thus, we cannot hold ourselves to any such deal, you see. And because we cannot hold ourselves to any deal with God, because there is no deal, we ourselves have to recognize absolute freedom that we are, that God created us as absolute freedom, and therefore we recognize true creativity. And in recognizing true creativity, the falseness of false creativity becomes absolutely apparent to us, and we realize there is no fixation whatsoever. Not even beautiful fixation. So the world has been seduced, and it opened us up to this hostile takeover by cosmic corporate culture, which comes from other places in the cosmos. It's very organized. It's very technological. It's very scientific, technological, very organized. and very capable of taking over hostile takeovers, and this is what's happened already on this planet. So, you know, we might think, oh, the Western tradition, or Eastern too, is the same thing. I mean, you're renunciates. I mean, the idea that Eastern is soft on you is not true at all. Eastern teachers are not soft at all. Monastic living. Renunciation. Severe, severe rules and restrictions. And we might think, oh, that's so oppressive. It's oppressing the muse, you know. It's oppressing the, you know, you want to call whatever you want to call it. The inner feminine, they try to divide and conquer. What they try to do is divide the genders here and create, you know, this conflict between male and female here, as if this restriction of false creativity was somehow direct oppression of women, you know, which is not true at all. Absolutely not true. But the hostile takeover twisted and distorted this, which is easy to do, actually. But keep in mind, many, many, many women in the past have been renunciates and have restricted their false creativity and developed discipline, full stop in the wowness and quiet contemplation, and got glimpses of freedom. And some actually have been liberated, as same with men. And of course, there is no men or women, actually, we're just spirit. But, you know, those who identify with the female body have been liberated. But they did it the same way that men did it. Restricting false creativity, practicing full stop on the wow, disciplining yourself, managing your success, and seeing there is no deal to be made with God whatsoever. And of course, false creativity, divide and conquer is the motto of cosmic corporate culture. So it came into this world, it divided us, it divided the generations, it divided the genders, and now we have this horrible, you know, culture wars and gender wars and all this stuff. All this is based on spiritual laziness and our unwillingness to continue the path of discipline. There's no arguments truly between spirits identifying with male or female. The path is the same. Path is the same. It's not some different path for females or different path for men, not at all. But it's cosmic corporate culture that has brought this false, distorted, false pathness to this world that has set off this conflict here in the world. They bring conflict with them. And you can feel in this world how extraordinarily conflicted it is now compared to like the 1950s or 60s. It's like night and day. It's like the difference between a sunny day and a cold, stormy night. We're in a horribly cold, stormy night now. Races are at each other's throats. Genders are at each other's throats. Politics are at each other's throats. Everyone's at each other's throats. This is the result of this horror. And then, of course, cosmic corporate culture comes in on this gray horse. They claim it's white, it's a gray horse, and saying, oh my gosh, look at you. Look how terrible and conflicted you all are. Here, we'll bring in the answer, which is what? Regulation, 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 controlling your life, monitoring your life down to the last, you know, being totally monitored at all times, being told what to do in order to avoid this so-called conflict. So what they do is they bring about this conflict in order to, you know, they foment a crisis in order then to come in and say they're the answer for the crisis. This is their MO. This is the MO. This is their modus operandi. This is exactly what they're doing here. And these operatives are in high positions of leadership of nations and stuff. They intentionally rile up racial tensions, rile up conflicts between people in the police, people in authority, rile up gender conflicts, rile up all these conflicts. So people just feel like, oh my gosh, we're going to have a civil war. And then they come and say, you know, hey, follow me and I will, you know, I'll put everyone under my authority and I'll tell everyone what to do and everyone will be fine. And people then willingly follow these demagogues who are working for cosmic corporate culture, actually. lead us right into the pit. That's what they do. And of course, it's fairness, they say. It's not fair that false creativity isn't the same as true creativity. That's not fair. We need to make it fair. We need to make them equal. You need to work for equality and justice and all this stuff. You know, this is the spiel of cosmic corporate culture, as opposed to the true teachings of religions of both East and West, and middle and all over the world, is no. We need to severely restrict false creativity. We need to severely discipline ourselves. We need to practice sitting quietly. We need to practice forgiveness and compassion. And we need to understand that it's not easy for us. We need to understand we have a continuity fear. We need to understand that we need to manage our success because we will succeed. And ultimately, we need to set down this false creativity in exchange for true creativity. And we need to set down the notion that we can make a deal with God, ultimately. And we can do all of this. And when we do this, we will find we're not alone, because there are those who have done it. In the Western tradition, we say that Jesus is already free from the grave, which is absolutely true. So we will not be alone. There are others who also are free of it. There's no question about that, too. We will certainly not be alone. But we don't necessarily have to be, you know, all-encompassing connoisseurs of a religious past, spiritual past. We can focus on one. That is fine. For me, I needed to have more of an overview to see the seduction of a goddess who's distorting these teachings and seducing us into the belief in this equality of false creativity and true creativity. It's helped me out to be able to see through it. I say, wait a minute. You know, this is very clever manipulation of teachings to make them seem like they're supporting the false position. So certainly someone can take the path, the Christian path, and be liberated. Absolutely. And they don't have to know anything about other paths, actually. It's not necessary. If they're able to stay true to this path, absolutely. But it is certainly not easy right now in this world to do so. And so I needed to tell people what's actually happening here. You know, is this blueprint for hostile takeover of this planet? Is exactly what's happening. This is something that Jesus knew about 2,000 years ago. He knew that there was a blueprint being developed for a hostile takeover of this planet by cosmic corporate culture. And he said, you need to really be liberated before that takeover, you know, by the time that takeover actually is completed, you need to be ready to be liberated from this situation, actually. And so you need to have, you know, this couple thousand years of focusing on this, because this cosmic corporate culture is very clever indeed. And our continuity fear is very strong, and our vulnerability to this seduction, we're very vulnerable to it. We're like severe drug addicts that easily we get pulled back into it. So he says you really need to have a good amount of time to work on this. But now, you say, where are we at now? Where we need to be? I'm speaking for those who are hearing this and accepting this into their minds. We're exactly where we need to be. Recognition now is complete in terms of this deal. There's no deal with God. You don't say, we say, God, you have to accept this deal. We have no authority to force a deal upon God was and whatsoever. And the deal was, we said, hey God, we want to be greater than God. God's perfect. So he said, the only way is to find a flaw in God. So we said, God, we see a flaw in you. And then we feel this sense of perfection still there. And that's, we feel God's asserting, no, I'm perfect. And we say, well, God, we have this conflict and we're not one anymore. So in order to be one again, we have to compromise, make a deal. So we'll say, okay, we won't assert that you have that reality is flawed, that you're flawed, and you need to drop the assertion that you're perfect. Okay? And then we say, if you don't do this, there's a perfect compromise. If you don't do this, that means that you're not perfect, because it's a perfect compromise, and perfection would recognize this. Therefore, you have to accept this. And then so then we assume that God has accepted this deal. And all we're doing is deceiving ourselves about this. But basically what we're saying is, God, I'm not going to say you're imperfect as long as you say you're imperfect. And we call that a deal. What deal is that? It's not a deal. We know we can't make deals with God, so we put this simple, this arrogance into a form of a deal, as if it was a deal. It's not, it's just sheer arrogance. Sheer effrontery, sheer arrogance, that's all it is. And what we wanted to pretend, oh no, I'm not being arrogant. I'm not trying to be greater than God. I recognize that there's this deal that needs to be made. Wait a minute, we said, wow. In one side there's this saying God's imperfect, the other side God's saying it's perfect, and there's a conflict here, a dualistic conflict. Well, let's resolve it. Perfect resolution is each side will agree with the other, and we'll have a deal. I agree, God, okay, you're perfect. If you agree with the other side saying, oh, I'm not perfect. All that is sheer arrogance of saying that God's imperfect, put into this clever little deal that we, you know, this is what we've done. This is what we're still doing. This is the idea. We made a deal with God. We didn't make any deal with God. We just engaged in sheer arrogance and claiming that God is imperfect and we're better than God. We're greater. That's it. That's all we can do. If we desire to be greater than God, all we can do is just engage in sheer arrogance. But because we recognize that's not true. It's sheer arrogance. We disguise it. We've tried to camouflage it from ourselves. God is not fooled by this, but we've tried to deceive ourselves. So we just engage in self-deception, believing that we made a deal, a perfect compromise deal with God. And that God being perfect, of course God accepted this perfect compromise. And therefore, we feel we're bound by this deal. And the chain of consequences of this is we believe that absolute freedom is actually annihilation, death, our destruction. But we can be saved by that, by fixating on time, space, process, and form. That somehow our freedom has been fixated. And that's God's part of the deal, being, you know, fair to us. So we get to fixate on what we think are bodies. And us being fair to God is that these bodies do have to die. You see? That's the chain of consequences of this. So we're able to recognize this clearly. We're able to laugh along with it. And this is, you know, getting to where we need to get to in terms of this hostile takeover of this planet, the ideology of this planet. We most certainly have to have the clear light shining upon this. Clear light of reason shining upon all of this. And we do. We absolutely do. And so this is a bit of a wow. Say, okay, wow. That's great. And, you know, we're getting at ease with it. This is the getting familiar with it is the key. It's not enough to read in a book, some words in a book, and say, oh, I understood the words. No, we need to actually see it and recognize it. In seeing it, you're able to look at the chain of consequences, the folly of it, to laugh at it. This means you're actually recognizing it. It's not you're just parroting back, you know, something you read or someone said it. No, we're recognizing this here. The spirit of recognition is here. This is what we need to have: the spirit of recognition. Jesus will ask us, "Do you have the spirit of recognition?" Say, "Yes, yes, I'm getting familiar with the spirit of recognition." Breathing the air of recognition, as it were. Able to breathe. We're able to breathe, spiritually breathe here. So the so-called modern New Age Renaissance is really all about trying to elevate false creativity to make it equal to true creativity. And those who are engaged in that think that they're engaged in some vastly important liberation movement of freedom and fairness and equality and justice, and are triumphing over the dreadful darkness of repression and all this. And they are absolutely mistaken and being severely misled by the cleverness of cosmic corporate culture. That's sometimes referred to as Lucifer or Satan or whatever, meaning very clever cosmic cleverness that is capable of deceiving us in a very, very clever ways. Call it the CCC, Cosmic Corporate Culture. But Jesus certainly overcame that and has told us how we can overcome it too. And we are overcoming it. We are breathing the air of familiarity with recognition. So we don't need to think that we need to stay engaged with the future of outworkings of this planet. That's absolutely ridiculous. All that is raising, trying to raise false creativity to the level of true creativity, which is an exercise in absurdity and futility and darkness. Place is becoming extremely dark. I mean, it's so you can just see it, right? And all the motifs, artistic motifs, of all the serpents and reptiles and war and violent conflict. People think they're so evolved. We get to online, we can be involved in these, you know, world of war, world of conflict, and engage in these vicious, you know, battles and killings and slaughtering and mayhem, et cetera, et cetera. Online, we can, any place we have a smartphone, we can do this on a beach somewhere. We can engage in this, you know, vicious conflict and triumph. You know, we're using our creativity, you know, and we can go to any number of food places, and we just indulge the senses in so many ways here. And we think, oh yeah, I got to be part of that. This is some wonderful golden age we're going into. No, this is absolute. We're going into the pit. Going into the pit of hell, actually, is what's really taking place here. So we don't need to pay any attention to that, because we already know what disciplines are necessary. And when you get tired of the pit of hell, disciplines will be reintroduced. That's all. Now, you may be a brilliant musician, let's say. Well, you'll have a life where you're going to restrict that. That's what I tried to do in this life, and unfortunately the goddess was able to hook me again and cause severe problems, but I was able to get unhooked, which the goddess claims is impossible. She loves to claim that. No, once I've hooked you, you can never be unhooked from me. Not true. It's like saying, once you're hooked by false creativity, you can never be unhooked by false creativity. Once you've made a deal with God, you can never be free of that deal, because God is eternal. So the deal must be eternal too. That's a lie. God is eternal. But the lie part of it is, that's a half-truth lie, it's called. The lie of it is that a deal can be made with God. There's no deal that can be made with God. So it's impossible to be hooked by any deal. So we can certainly get free of that hook. There's no eternal hook of any deal. No deal has any eternal hook to it whatsoever. It's only the hook of self-deception. So I got back into music this lifetime. I tried my best to stay away from it. So I've been fighting a battle my whole life to get free of this. I'm getting freer and freer and freer and freer and freer. And of course the goddess says, no, I'm always going to have you hooked. You can't get free of me. And smiles her little smug smile, you know, like she knows best. She knows better. No, she doesn't. She's a fool, a moron. the goddess is a moron, okay, and doesn't know best at all. In fact, doesn't know truth at all. Is completely blind to truth. False creativity is totally blind to truth. So we have a situation of the blind leading the blind in this world now, going straight into the pit of hell. And we think that we can just say we're not sinners, and this, and then we can celebrate this false creativity. Well, we're being idiotic, okay? We're being foolish. We are severe sinners. Any mind that believes it's a body in the slightest bit is an extreme sinner. Any taste of the grave that we, if we have the slightest taste of the grave, we're an extreme sinner. Period. Again, it has to be pointed out over and over again. This is absolutely true. Meaning we're believing it's possible to make a deal with God, which actually is our camouflaging of our extreme arrogance of trying to simply arrogate that we're greater than God, which is based on a whim of our adventurousness and our freedom, saying, hey, maybe we're free to not be free. You know, and this is what we're trying to do. Yeah, we're so free that we're able even to be not be free. But this is an obvious contradiction, isn't it? The one thing we're not free to be is not free. God is not contradicting itself, okay? God is not a self-contradiction. So freedom means freedom. Freedom means you're free. It doesn't mean you're also not free. It does not mean that. And radical Dzogchen does not teach that, regardless what anyone might say. Freedom means you're free, period. No fixation means there's no fixation, period. And our continuity fear makes us afraid of that. We go running back to the goddess of false creativity and saying, oh my gosh, this is too severe. Are you kidding me? I want to trust in you. I mean, can you give me some nice music, please, or something, you know? She'll say, sure. God is so strict, so severe. He just doesn't understand. You know, he's not gentle, and God's not gentle enough. And I'm your mother. I'll be gentle and nice to you, and I'll give you the music and the love and the sex, the drugs, the rock and roll, and all of that. And I'll eventually, God will understand that you're not going to put up with this severity and stuff and absoluteness, and you're going to bring about this more balanced, equitable, fair situation, and that's going to be your true life. And God is just forcing this deal upon you too severely, and you know, you get all this, oh, poor baby sort of stuff, you know, like the mother is consoling the poor child. You're crying tears. I'm scared of this absolute non-fixationness. And she says, don't worry. I have a much better reality for you, and God will eventually see the light. This is what you get. This is what you get here. And you have to keep turning away from that. And cosmic corporate culture says, oh, you know, you're turning away from this false matriarchal mother goddess worshiping, you know, deception. You know, oh, you're anti-women then. You know, they love, that's how they keep playing this card over and over, because it works. They keep playing the card. You know, nowadays, anything you say against that cosmic corporate culture hostile takeover, they twist it into saying, you're anti-female, you're anti-women. You know, you're anti-equality, you're anti-something, you know, like that. They just immediately, that's their mindset. They put it into that instantly, and then you think, oh, I'm guilty, I'm wrong, I'm bad, and stuff. And so they know their business of guilt. They know their business. Their business is confusion and guilt. And they lead you down into the pit of hell, actually, thinking that it's liberation that you're going towards. That you're being liberated from God, actually, is what they tell you. Being liberated from truth. Being liberated from absoluteness. No, there's no liberation from absoluteness. We can never escape it. It's a waste of time. Going down to the pit of hell is a waste of time. You have no choice. There is no deal you can make with God, and you cannot arrogate yourself as greater than God, and disguising that as a deal is useless, is futile. Reality has no deals to make. So we have no choice but to take the path of true liberation from false liberation. We must be truly liberated from false liberation. And the world, the gospel of the world right now, the anti-gospel, is one of false liberation. No question about it. And many have recognized this, and yet they're super oppressed right now, and they feel like, you know, besieged, actually. They feel besieged. And the cosmic corporate culture is calling everyone, hey, be leaders of the liberation. You can be heroes and heroines of liberating us from this oppression that you've been under. Yeah, why should you be restricting this creativity? You should indulge. If you feel like it feels good, do it. You know, just indulge yourself. And, you know, this is the false liberation. And you're being told that you can be a leader of this, and you'll be a heroine, a heroine of the revolution, and everyone will be so thankful to you for liberating them from this discipline and restrictions and all this stuff. But many have recognized, no, this is false. This is leading me down to the pit of hell, actually. And there are many in the world that know this now, realize it, but the oppression of cosmic corporate culture at a governmental, bureaucratic, institutional, corporate level throughout all the news, information, entertainment, education, bureaucracy, restriction, all of this is oppressing the world so severely right now that they're feeling like, well, maybe I do need to make a deal here. Maybe I do need to believe in deals, you know. And keep in mind, Jesus didn't make a deal with God. I mean, this is one of the mistakes that Christians have made. There's no deal you can make with God whatsoever. None. There's no deal we can make with God. We have to recognize that the belief in a deal is a camouflaging of our arrogance, our spiritual pride, thinking we can simply arrogate ourselves to be higher than God, greater than perfection, to be more perfect than perfection. There isn't any more perfect than perfectionists to get to. So we are simply perfect as God is perfect, except God is the prime creator, the source of this perfection, not us. But we are no less perfect than God in the perfection that is. And there isn't any higher perfection to get to. So we have no choice but to recognize that there aren't any deals, set down this notion of deals with God. And no choice but to set down false creativity for true creativity, the true creativity of absolute freedom, which is beyond anything that false creativity can ever imagine, actually. This is what Jesus tells us directly, saying, what is it, when we ask, what is it like, this true creativity, this absolute freedom? And Jesus says, there's no way it can be explained to you in your imaginingness, your imageness, your play with imagery. There's no way you can understand it that way. It's impossible. So don't even try. But it's glorious beyond anything you can imagine, what Jesus says. You can't even imagine a fragment of it, he says. So we don't even try. So all this false creativity can never, ever give us even a fragment of what true creativity is really like. So it's useless, it's futile. You know, don't waste our time on it. Now, people thought, when I returned to this world, that I was going to continue with my false creativity of music, and so they thought I had great potential. You know, they were expecting me to do something great, but it turns out my purpose was to get free of that. So there was a lot of conflict. A lot of people were disappointed in me. My friends dropped me. I became friendless here, except for Jesus. I found a friend in Jesus, actually. He said, "Don't worry, I've already free from the grave. I'm already free from the taste of the grave. And I'll be there for you when you get free also." Everybody else that I knew just went on sex, drugs, rock and roll. You know, let's elevate false creativity to equal status with God. Let's elevate the goddess to be equal to God. And all nonsense about we need to talk about God as God Goddess. You know, that's such utter nonsense, because God is completely abstract, and to use two terms to relate to God introduces the idea of false creativity being equal to true creativity. Absolutely it does. So just use one term to refer to God. God is a neutral term, actually. It's not a male term. It's not a female term. It refers to pure abstraction. And some religion says that God has no name at all. You can't say the name of God because it's absolute freedom. How can absolute freedom actually have a name, so to speak, you know? So there's a big movement as this false liberation continues. Even like there's a book, A Course in Miracles, and someone who's put in, every time you speak of God, you say, is now God / Goddess. And of course soon it will be Goddess / God. Okay, guaranteed. Guaranteed, mark my word. And this is just a travesty. This is an absolute travesty. You know, they use the him, her, his, you know, trying to, you know, this is nonsense. Anyone on the spiritual path understands we have to keep our distance from the goddess of culture and false creativity. And so we lean away from that. Okay, so the use of him and father and God, whatever, is just a temporary expedient to stay away from the matriarchal goddess worshiping, false creativity worshiping, elevating tendencies that we have, which are extremely severe. But ultimately, spirit has no gender at all. God has no gender. Spirit has no gender. Absolute freedom has no gender whatsoever. So the last thing we want to do is try to say, oh no, it has two genders. It's male and female. That is absolute nonsense. And that's again camouflaging our desire, our arrogance. It's a camouflage for our arrogance, saying that we can elevate false creativity to level of true creativity, elevate fixation to the level of absolute freedom. Absolute freedom doesn't have any level. You can't elevate anything to it. So you can't attain it. You can't arrive at it, you see. That's all arrogance. Even our idea we can attain realization, we can arrive at truth, that's all arrogance. We've never left. There are no layers or levels. So sometimes I use, you know, him or her, so people are so conditioned right now, brainwashed, that they're taught to be kind of outraged, you know, and what is their outrage? Is this their arrogance? How dare anyone suggest that I'm being spiritually arrogant? No, this is all just a deal, a perfect deal that I've made, and now I'm just making sure that the deal is perfect from our side too. You know, God has too much weight in this deal. We're going to make our side perfect too. You know, this is nonsense. This is arrogance. So when they're conditioned that when their arrogance gets pointed out, they're supposed to get infuriated. How dare you suggest that, you know, there's not equality here in of false creativity with true creativity? That's what they're really saying. Whereas others who are on the spiritual path aren't bothered at all by this. In fact, they're happy, you know, to get away from the false creativity as much as possible, having been burned by it over and over and over again. Now, there isn't any false creative superstar that I can't counsel, that is for sure. I'm not in awe or intimidated, been there and done that. So, you know, it doesn't matter who you have been in a past life, whatever. This teaching is absolutely appropriate for you. Restrict that false creativity. Don't say, do you know who I was in a previous life? I was this awesomely creative being. How dare you say I restrict my creativity? Blah, 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 blah. No, I absolutely dare to say it, because I restricted my own. I restricted the creativity I was involved with, which was, you know, can hold up with anyone's. Not that matters much anyway, but it does carry some weight here to say, hey, if I did it, you can do it too. if it's good for me, it's going to be good for you too. I mean, I think there's some who are like so extremely creative that they feel, no, this won't work for me. Somehow I'm perpetually hooked by this false creativity. That is not true. That is not true. I guarantee you it's not true. Doesn't matter how much you serve the goddess, you are not hooked by the goddess. Absolutely not. She has no hook upon you, no true hook upon you whatsoever. The hook is your own arrogance, spiritual arrogance. That's the hook. That's the only hook there is, and this simply is futile. As it doesn't really go do anything for us, so we can just set it down with a good laugh, you know, play a joke on ourselves. So no matter how much you have served the goddess in whatever capacity, I'm absolutely qualified to tell you that you are not hooked by it in any way. You're not hooked by it anyway. The only hook is a continuity fear, nothing else. And so if, you know, someone says, well, okay, great, but let's go have some fun with our false creativity now. Look, you know how much fun we can have. Let's put the band back together, you know, in other words. You know, let's go put the band back. Are you kidding me? Let's go put the band of false creativity back together. I'll say, no, we're not doing that. We're not doing that. They say, but, you, together, we could, you know, just blow everyone's minds with how beautiful them, you know. No, we're not doing that. We're not here to try to blow people's minds with false creativity. We're here to blow their minds with true liberation. Liberation from our own arrogance, from us camouflaging that arrogance as a deal, and us camouflaging this even further by claiming, you know, that we're living up to our end of the deal and making sure that God lives up to God's end of the deal and managing this deal as if, you know, we have to manage it properly, you know. Just getting, you know, we're seeing through all of this now. We keep thinking this deal should work for us, but it's not work. Something's wrong. But so some either God or us is not living up to it properly, and we think God is being too severe in this deal, and God needs to back off and let us, you know, indulge in our false creativity. Indulge in a belief, you know, in fixation. God is somehow pressuring us too much. We feel that way, you know. So the goddess comes to our rescue. Oh, yeah, God's pressuring you too much. The father is being too strict. But here's the mother saying, oh, here, have the sweet. It's okay. Just don't tell God, just don't tell father about it, you know. You hear about it all the time. And the child thinks, oh, the mother's really good on my side. Later on, they find out, oh, it's not true. It was the father who was demanding discipline, self-discipline, that was really on my side. You know, the strictness. Now, the mothers can be strict too, and it can be the opposite way. Okay. Where the father is the indulgent one, and the mother is saying, no, you got to be strict. You got to discipline yourself. That can also be true, right? But In this bigger cosmic picture, the false creativity comes up to you like a mother would come to a child, where the child is crying and saying, you know, and then she says, what's wrong? God is just too strict. He's pushing this deal, his side, too much on me. And she says, oh, yeah, I know. That's not fair, is it? No, the child says. Crying child. She goes, listen, don't worry. I have ways. Child says, oh, really? She says, yes. I will support you, you know, in what you're doing. And eventually, God will have no choice but to be less demanding, you know. You say, oh, great, God has helped me out there. I worship you so much. Thank you so much. And you're just going down into the pit of hell. Prolonging your stay in the pit of hell, actually, is what you're doing. So you just tell the goddess, not now, goddess, I'm in full stop in the wow mode. She says, come on, let's play. Not now, goddess. I'm in full stop in the wow mode. Well, when you're done with that, let's go play. Say, no, I might play a little bit, but not very much, and I'll loop it right back into practice, and I'll practice more and more full stop in the mode, and you're on the way out, actually. Just have to be very severe with it. Otherwise, for sure, you're going to be pulled down, for sure. And regret it. You'll continue to taste the grief. So you may think the goddess is all very nice. She's like, let's play with false creativity. The price you pay is will continue to taste the grave. So how nice is the goddess, really? How nice is that wonderful playmate? She says, come on, let's play. Let's run through the meadows together. You know, how nice is that, really? The price you pay, you will continue to taste the grave. And then, of course, she'll tell you to blame God for that. The muse of false creativity will tell you, oh, yeah, well, that's God's fault that you're still tasting the grave. He's still mean. And you just need to stay with me, and we need to keep working at it even more, and then we'll get rid of that meanie. So there are women under the spell of the goddess, and you can tell that very easily. There are women who are not under the spell of the goddess, and you can tell that too. There are men who are under the spell of the goddess, and there are men who are not so much, not under the spell of the goddess. I mean, so much. It's varying, you know, intensities. If we were completely free of the spell of the goddess, we'd be enlightened. We would not be tasting the grave at all. Jesus tells us, if you even taste the slightest bit of the grave, you're not free. You're still following a mixed message. You're still in the spell of your arrogance. Even the slightest bit, he says. That's how absolute Jesus is. Jesus is very much an absolute teacher, as are all true teachers. They're not wishy-washy about it. They're absolute. They tell you this absolutely. He says himself, or Jesus himself. He's not a he or a she. He's a golden light. He said, I don't taste the slightest taste of the grave at all. None. I taste no infirmity whatsoever. None of the grave, so to speak, of, you know, fatigue, suffering, aging, wearing down, fear, vulnerability. I don't taste even the slightest bit of that, Jesus tells us. That's his confession, that to us. Not the slightest bit of it. He said, and you won't either, once you drop this arrogance, you know. You won't feel it either. But if you do feel it, you haven't dropped it yet, you see. So you're still under the spell to some extent. Spell of false creativity and its muse. Which is why at times I suggested just say, just wow. Yeah, that's all you need to say. Just say, wow. That's a discipline. It's a practice. Now we understand in these disciplines and practices, we understand our tendency to fall back a little bit into false creativity. And so we're not indulgent of this, but we're compassionate of it. So we don't applaud it, but we recognize it for what it is and say, okay, let's get back. You know, let's get back on track here. Let's make greater efforts. It will stay with us until we finally set it down. And we set it down not in hatred or in anger or fear, but just in recognition with a laugh and say, okay, this was, you know, just a silly little game I was playing of my own of arrogance, and I don't need this anymore. But I respect, I honor my creativity that I was trying to be creatively non-creative. It's like that. And it's quite amazing that this putting these graphics up suddenly became non-functional in this video, as I started out with all these cool graphics that I've been doing, and they suddenly became, it suddenly became non-functional, and it's still non-functional right now. Beautiful. That's the Holy Spirit at work. And I tended to put those in there because I realize right now at this point, the intensity is so strong. I says, you know, okay, let's give you, toss a bone, you know. It's like we think, oh my gosh, I'm seeing that false creativity is false now. Oh my gosh, you know, just like, so we want to honor our creativity, even though it's been employed with false creativity. You know, I want to honor it a little bit. And so I think that's what I'm doing here is I'm not just, you know, being ruthless. No, we're not ruthless. We're compassionate. We're adamant, but not ruthless. I still can't get any of these graphics to pop up. That's great. We'll be graphics free here. Although even this image here is a graphic play of false creativity here. Yeah, we're going to remain, create image-free, I mean, graphic-free here. Absolutely wonderful. So the Holy Spirit says, come on, you can do that. And, you know, once we're in the wow, you know, it's better just to stay in the wow like this. So by coming down really strong on this false creativity, I want to assure you that it doesn't mean that there's some sort of, you know, vicious hatred in here. No, I still engage in false creativity. And so just a reassuring that, yeah. You can, you know, you will still, you know, you won't become some vicious iconoclastic mindset. No, I mean, corporate culture has tried to scare us into thinking that anyone who becomes adamantly religious is somehow going to be blowing up, you know, monuments and defacing and destroying and etc. We have that going on right now in the world. This is not true at all. It's absolutely not true. This is a very much of a falsity that is being foisted upon this world. The whole ISIS thing is very much a falsity in terms of overzealousness, and it's giving all religion a bad name. And this is intentionally being promulgated by cosmic corporate culture to scare everybody off, you know, being very vigilant and very restrictive, but at the same time also being forgiving and compassionate, and right? And that's what all, you know, religions do teach, is forgiveness and compassion, understanding we have these weaknesses. It's like an alcoholic. You backslide. What do? You don't, like, you know, try to, you know, become vicious towards him. You say, hey, you're backsliding. You gotta get out of that. That's not good for you. Get back to your discipline, like that. Someone just told me yesterday, you know, he says, I'm an alcoholic. You know, I drink every night. They're honest about it. I didn't tell them stop it. I didn't judge them. And then they're talking about they might have some problems with their health. I'm not sure. Maybe it's just the alcohol, whatever it is. Okay. All right, but, you know, that's not the way. It's not the way. So I was very kind and supportive, you know. But at the same hand, you have to be very restrictive and disciplined. Absolutely, you do. No way around it. Don't think that this liberation that we've been undergoing in this world for the last 50 years or so is somehow kind and good to you. It is absolutely not. It's the opposite. Don't think that dropping all your great disciplines and restrictions, etc., is somehow helpful for you. It's not helpful at all. Just the opposite. It causes about a great deal of regret as you continue to taste the grave for a long time. And you delay, you delay, you delay. And as you delay, you continue to taste the bitter taste of the grave all the time. People are falling back into bad habits right now. There's no question, right? Because the pressure's on for you to fall back into bad habits. That is the pressure that the world is under, is to fall back into bad habits. And, you know, I don't know, depending how you look at it, I tend to be pretty critical of the Pope Francis because I feel he's empowering that. And where he needs to be very strict about it and say no. I think he's trying to be too clever, you know, trying to be too ecumenical. I mean, there's a fine line there. And maybe he feels that he's walking that line. And I think a lot of people feel that he's gone over the line, actually. Vatican II does not mean freedom, all this liberation of false creativity. It absolutely does not mean that. But it's been taken to mean that. And he seems to be continually backing off being strict about being a good shepherd and telling us no, the restrictions are all still in place, you know, no way, we're not dropping any restrictions. He needs to be very adamant about that, and he's really seems to be empowering and emboldening cosmic corporate culture to feel like, oh, we can take over the church, we can destroy the church, we can destroy this vast tradition of diligence and restrictiveness and discipline. Yeah, we're you know, we can do it. You know, so you know, it's the good shepherd should be adamant and clear about at all times that in no way are we dropping, is the need for discipline and restriction on false creativity, in no way is that necessity ever, can we ever be free of that. We must take that path, and we must protect that path and guard that path from sabotage, which cosmic corporate culture is ceaselessly engaging in to weaken us, termiting this world. We must protect ourselves from termiting. And setting an example, which is basically saying, no, let's let the termites, that's fine, that's not, you know, it's all good. And that is, I mean, I even feel myself like I cannot be as adamant as I want to be because, you know, the authority of this huge institution seems to be very laissez-faire about it and say, oh, no, it's okay, it's not that big of a deal. You know, I say, whoa, wait a minute. That is not the gospel, the shepherding of the gospel that is called for. So, you know, whatever it is, I mean, you know, maybe he feels he's doing the best he can or something, but we certainly hold ourselves to higher standards here. We absolutely hold ourselves to higher standards. The Pope is not the ultimate standard. Jesus is. And the Holy Spirit and Jesus and ultimately God is. And ultimately we are, because we are one with God. We are perfect, actually, in God. And so we have every right to hold ourselves to a higher standard than the Pope holds us to. Absolutely, we have that right. We have a right to hold ourselves to a higher standard than anyone holds us to, any religious authority. If they are somehow, you know, sort of trying to compromise, we have absolute right to hold ourselves to a higher standard. I mean, the Pope has a job which is largely political, actually. And I'm not restrained by that. So my job is 100% straight on spiritual liberation. So I can assert a higher standard. The Pope is just trying to figure out how to get along with cosmic corporate culture. Well, guess what? You can't. You can't. It's never said that the church age is going to last forever. In fact, we're told very clearly by Jesus it doesn't last forever. and that there's a harvest that takes place. And this world does go into darkness. And that there is all sorts of stuff happens here, actually. So at the end of the church age, which we're clearly at, why try to play footsie with cosmic corporate culture and pretend we'll just be able to compromise with them and get along and have a nice workable compromise? That is a very questionable tactic, actually. Very, very much questionable. I think now's the time to be adamant. Now's the time to say, no, there's no compromise. And cosmic corporate culture say, well, we rule the whole universe. There's no place you can go. You can't escape us. And they say, well, you're full of it. You don't control all places by any means. Jesus has